Robin sir, is a lie. You can start the program right now.
Respected dignitaries and dear participants, a warm good afternoon to one and all, and welcome to this online seminar on higher studies and career in management hosted by School of Management Studies, Cochin University of Science and Technology, and co-hosted by Mar Beselios Institute of Technology and Science. Let's start the program with a silent prayer for 1 minute. Thank you. Management is the coordination and administration of tasks to achieve a goal. It does have a certain meaning as a career option. If we get right management education, I hope this seminar will help us to understand the scope of management education's career opportunities, preparation, and eligibility criteria for reputed management programs in India. And any queries in this regard may be clarified.
Today, we have got an eminent speaker with us, Dr. Rakesh Krishnan M., who will enlighten us on the topic Higher Studies and Careers in Management. Without much delay, let me invite Ms. Renu Mary George, Assistant Professor, Electrical and Electronics Engineering Department, to welcome the gathering and introduce the guest speaker for the session. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Grayson. A very good morning to all the dignitaries, faculty, students, and all gathered here. Without much introduction, let me get into my duty. It's indeed a very great pleasure to welcome you all to this online seminar that is expected to give us a very good insight into various career options and courses in management sector. And we are very much lucky that we have got the very right person as our resource person, that is Dr. Rakesh Krishnan M., currently the Associate Professor, School of Management Studies, Cochin University of Science and Technology, CUSAT, Kochi. So on behalf of MBITS, with great delight, I welcome you, sir, to this occasion.
Thank you, madam.
Then our principal, Dr. P. Sojanlal, who has got 30 years of blended experience with major petroleum companies in Middle East and premier educational institutions in India. And he has always been there as our captain for all the curricular and co-curricular activities. So with great pleasure, I welcome you, sir, to this virtual meeting. Now, I would also like to welcome all the deans, heads of various departments, faculty members, and of course, my dear students to this online seminar. And I wish all the participants to gain the maximum out of this online seminar. So once again, I welcome all to this gathering. And now we have got our respected principal, Dr. P. Sojanlal, sir. I request, sir, to address the gathering. Sir. Hello. Okay, I think Principal sir lost the connection. So now let me directly get in. Yes, sir.
Renu.
Yes, sir. Sir, I request you to address the gathering with a few words.
Good morning to all of you. And first of all, thank you very much for conducting jointly with. Hello.
Good morning, sir. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Good morning.
Thank you very much for School of Management Studies, QSAT, for organizing, being a host of this function, and we are delighted to program. And also that we hope that this will be the first program in the series where we'll be conducting this for giving additional information for the student for higher education opportunities within in India and abroad. And once again, thank you, Jai Rai sir, being the director of School of Management Studies for taking the initiative in a very much useful way. And I'm sure that this will be very much beneficial for the students also. And also the resource person, sir, thank you very much for your valuable time. And my dear students, this is a very rare opportunity which you are going to get from the School of Management Studies. They will open up various avenues, particularly in the management education and the higher education opportunities in within India and abroad. And this will be very much useful for you also. And also we are trying to conduct a more number of programs in engineering fields and also other interested areas also within India and abroad also in the coming sequence by our continuing education department, which is headed by Naveen Parapat, the assistant professor from the mechanical engineering department. Thank you for the entire team for the continuous education department for hosting such a wonderful program. And I wish that this will be very beneficial for the pre-finalists as well as for the finalist students and to fine-tune their future plans also. Once again, wishing you all the best and thank you very much for the opportunity. All the best. Bye-bye. I'll be there with my screen in the off mode with the video. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I'd like to introduce our eminent speaker, Dr. Rakesh Krishnan M. He is currently an associate professor at School of Management Studies, Cochin University of Science and Technology. He is a rank holder for his MCom degree from Kerala University. Dr. Rakesh has obtained his MPA degree in Marketing and Finance in 2005 and PhD from Faculty of Management Studies, University of Kerala in the year 2015. He has got 12 years of teaching experience and his interests are in the area of international finance, finance management, and financial accounting. He has presented various papers at international conferences and has published 9 research publications. He's author of 3 scholarly books, which have been published with ISBN. With this brief introduction, I would like to invite Dr. Rakesh Krishnan M. to deliver the talk on the topic, Higher Studies and Careers in Management. Sir, please.
Yeah, I think I'm audible. Renu, can you just check?
I'm yes, audible. Sir. Yes, yeah. Sir. Yes, sir. Oh, yeah. Yes, sir. You're audible.
So, good morning, Renu. Good morning, Principal sir, Sujan sir, and all other members of the faculty. I think Professor Jagatiraj, the director of SMSC, is also there. Good morning, sir. I also thank Litin, who was coordinating this function with me for the last 1 week. So this, in fact, is an incident. Yes. Yes, madam. Yeah. I'm not familiar with the various names. I think many of the senior faculty members are also there in this group. So good morning. I think it can be an open forum to an extent. The senior faculty members and other people who are having industry experience can also throw light on this particular topic which we are discussing. Yes. Okay. So, this was an initiative from the School of Management Studies from this year. The background was like, you know, we used to get a lot of applications where, you know, many of the students do not complete the proper application procedure. Many of the students who actually end up in different other programs, you know, finally find that this is not their cup of tea. And especially in India, it is like a routine after the plus two, they go for a graduation, then they go for a professional degree and then a final. So it's kind of a mass education, unlike in European or, you know, Western countries where, you know, only, you know, it's a niche area where, you know, only people who finally decide that, you know, they have to go into this particular route, they finally go for a professional education. So it also takes in a lot of money from the participants actually to, you know, take up the professional education. So it was in this context where we're thinking about, you know, to throw some light on, you know, how, you know, graduate students can plan their, you know, higher education or professional education if they plan to, or otherwise if they straight away would like to, you know, go into some kind of, you know, start off with some kind of career, you know, then that would also be some discussion points. So good morning, dear participants. I think since there are, you know, 300 numbers, I assume, you know, the participants will be from different streams, commerce and science and arts. I believe that is what I understand. So I have a small presentation so that, you know, I could, you know, structure my, you know, discussions in a line. So I'll also share with me my presentation. And this is Zoom platform. I think my presentation would be visible to you, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, it should be visible. Let me see if I can put it in the full screen mode also. So, okay, now I think it should be fine. So if anybody would want to ask something in between, you can just put on your mic and ask, because I put my presentation in a full screen. So sometimes I may not be able to see what happens in the chat box. So, any participants want to ask something, you can just put on your mic and ask, or probably you can also put the questions towards the end of the program. So this basically on, you know, higher education and career, especially into management. Your principal sir was saying about, you know, he was planning to host more programs in this line. Probably if somebody wants to have some orientation as to how to go about, you know, higher education in science area or technology area, I think Cochin University would be again resourceful. If you could put some requirement, you know, we could pass that on to other, you know, science and technology department also. So being said that, now coming back to careers in management. This career is something that, you know, is mind-wandering, and most of us at this point of time, probably after graduation now, you know, whether I should go in for a particular job, or, you know, should I go in for higher education, or should I be an entrepreneur of, you know, being creative by myself and, you know, trying to come out with something. So this one particular dilemma is there, or I assume it would be there in, you know, most of the students at the final year or pre-final year stage of a graduate program. If you look at our culture, you know, mostly, you know, students after, you know, graduation, they go for a higher education, especially in the management, or sometimes they go for other professional courses like M.Tech, or, you know, sometimes even to, you know, research area. But, you know, there are also a chunk of people who go into, you know, directly try applying, you know, some public sector jobs, PUC jobs, or into private sector jobs, you know, spend, you know, a few years there and come back, you know, and see, you know, okay, this is my line, so I have to probably have a professional education in that area. So this is probably what we see among the students, and the discussion is also, you know, set in this particular background. If you look at, you know, management, as far as our experience is concerned, you know, let us move a misconception or misunderstanding at the very outset. And our management is something for, you know, BCom students alone or BBA students alone. It is not like that. If you look at our you know, student portfolio, which is around, you know, 160 intake every year, you know, 30% of the students would be from BCom, 30-35% would be from BTech. We have students who are from statistics, mathematics, botany, zoology, nursing. We have a few of the doctors who are also joined the management program. So there are medical students. There are also a few of the defense who have come on deputation to our course. So there will be at least 4 or 5, you know, senior, you know, defense people at the captain or lieutenant level who are taking the MBA program at our department. So it is actually, it has a, it is applicable to every box of life or every different career that you can talk about. It is not something which is only into management, accounting or something like that. That's a traditional school. Now, at management level, the program tries to, you know, how an individual is taught or, you know, trained to work with a team in order to achieve some, you know, objectives. So when I say in a team, it could be a set of resources. So let us say a science student, you know, working in a R&D department, you know, he would have his colleagues who are probably working for a particular combination or a particular new drug, or engineer who is in a project management team. So when we talk about a team, it is a resource. It could be machinery, it could be patents, it could be people. So, you know, in management, what we try to do is, you know, in management studies or management programs, we try to, you know, give a scientific, you know, understanding as to how we can work with this team, with these resources. Maybe I'll be a single person, but I'll be having, my team would be set of other resources like capital. You'll be given with some money, capital, or you'll be given with some, you know, application softwares or a machinery with which you are supposed to work for a particular company or an organization. You should, you know, manage with these resources and, you know, probably get out to, you know, bring out better results with the minimum input or intake that you would need. So in our country, probably the management programs are, you know, popular management programs are management of business administration, MBA, you have PGDMs, which are offered by, you know, IIMs. Now I think they are also in university, they can also offer MBA. But if you look at globally, you know, most management programs, you know, there are executive level management programs. IIMs have started offering executive management programs. Cochin University of Science and Technology is also in the process of, you know, introducing executive level management programs. Maybe in a year or 2 years, you would be able to find the executive management programs from QSAT. Executive management programs are where, you know, usually, you know, people who work for 4 years or 5 years at mid-management level. And then they come back to higher education management, you know, and try to relate more of what their experience, and then they get back to industry. Slightly more costly than MBA program, but it is not very popular in our country as of now. So this is what, you know, a management, you know, education would mean to somebody who is not having any exposure to that. This seminar probably would help the participants or aspirants of, you know, management courses to understand the scope of management education, career opportunities, and how they would prepare to actually, you know, target a particular institution. That is very important. Like, you know, for example, you have a health problem, you would look at a particular hospital or a medical institution which would be, you know, the expert in that, is it not? For ortho, you would have certain specialist hospitals, or gynecology, you would have some specialization. So similarly, when you look at management also, there are different verticals in that. For example, somebody wants to, you know, take up HR or personal management. Somebody wants to look into analytics. Probably Calcutta, IIM Calcutta or Bangalore would be a better choice. Somebody wants to look into strategies. You have IIM instead of management institutes like that. So, you know, you have to target that and then probably try to prepare for those institutions because, you know, the competition will be at a higher level when you want to apply to good institutions. Okay. So this is basically the takeaway that, you know, you can expect from this program. You know, the scope of management education, what would be the career, you know, that you could look at after completing a good management program, and, you know, how do you actually prepare the road plan get into some of the target institutions. At this point, should I clarify anything? Anybody? So today's agenda, so we will have an introduction to the theme. We will have a discussion on higher education and management, especially in India. We'll also have a discussion on careers in management. And finally, we'll try to prepare an action plan if somebody would want to go into management education, how to do it. Okay, so introduction of the team, I think I have more or less already spoken to you. Industry, fourth revolution. Now we had first industrial revolution, second, third, and the fourth industrial revolution. It is called as 4.0 or 4.0 or something like that. So in the fourth revolution, this era, it is characterized by something like you would find that there are lesser human intervention into any processes or any practices. So you go into a bank and you could see, unlike earlier days, if you go and apply for a loan, probably the bank manager will ask you for your somebody to introduce to you. the bank manager may do a investigation as to what is your character, what is your other financial obligations. You would come to your neighbors and ask something. But now it is not like that. It is completely system driven in the sense you have something called the CIBIL score. Give your PAN number, and you could anybody could easily get what is your CIBIL score, and it is based on that. Probably a job is a loan is sanctioned or not. So the human intervention is limited to actually you use the correct technology or use the correct resource. You don't use so much of discretion on a regular basis. Maybe at the higher level, strategy level, you would use discretion, you would use your creativity, but otherwise, everything is more or less in a system. The human intervention is very, very minimal. So being said that, now, therefore, any discipline you take, science you take, or arts you take, or sports you take, or finance or economics you take, economic students can now easily go and work with a marketing team. A botany student can easily come and work in a banking company. Or a history student can easily come and work in a strategy team. It is all because what you need is a good attitude and capability to link with the system. So that is what is characterized by the fourth revolution. So that is a theme. So that is why we are requested that not only commerce students, any background can join, because any students, you could actually come in and take a management program. As I was discussing earlier, if you look at the QSAT portfolio, you have from medical students to history students, from nursing to entrepreneurs, you have economists, you have mathematicians, you have statistics students. So it is not like the BCom students or BBA students conventionally, as it happened, alone go for a management program. So that is a theme. Anybody could actually think of a management education, because now we work based on system driven processes, practices, and higher education in management, career in management. So we will come to that. So after graduation, is there anything in the chat box? If there is anything in the chat box, the moderator can just check and tell me, and not check the chat box. Okay. So after the graduation, I already told, it has become more system driven, letting diverse people to specialized jobs. So at this point, I would say, as finally year, graduate program participants, there are three things that you should definitely do at this point of time. One is to design. What is that you got to decide at this point of time? Somebody can put on your mic and tell me. What is that you have to decide? Students? I think moderator can give the permission for the participants to put on their mics if it is blocked. Anybody? Students? Yeah? I don't recognize you by the names. Somebody? Amal Krishna, Amal Eldos, Anju Jiji. Yeah, somebody can put on their mic. What is it that you have to decide at this point of time when you are at the brim of completing your graduate program and looking forward for something? So what is that you got to decide?
Career, perhaps.
That is a very broad answer. That is a very broad answer. You have to have a career plan. So that is what I'm asking also. What is the kind of plan, or what are the kind of things that you have to decide at this point of time?
Skills, actually.
That is an analysis. That is a self-appraisal. What is the skill set that you have? Are you a social person? Are you an introvert person? Or are you a creative person? Or are you a person who would like to socialize more? Are you a person who would like to be enterprising? So all these are different characters, one which is not comparable to others. So that is a self-appraisal, self-assessment, career set, your skill set. What is it you would desire at this point of time?
What is the one thing I can do right now to make sure that tomorrow I won't regret taking this decision?
In a way, I would agree to that. See, if you look at, even at QSAT, if you look at, or IIMs, you look at, there are, at least, every year we have, one or two or three or maybe sometimes five or more cases who fall into depression, who discontinue their course. You could see, people who would join, after maths, they join MSc. After that, they find that it is too monotonous, or it is not their cup of tea, though it is a very, very vibrant area. They finally, have to jump to something else. or some people initially, you know, jump onto some talks, then they find that no, it is too simple or not challenging for me. I should have done build up my own skill set, something more, and then I should have gone into a job. So there are a lot of possibilities where the youngsters regret. They are not happy as to what they have done after their graduation. It is because they would not have decided as to what they should do properly. They should have not planned as to what they would have, how they should have gone forward. So you should definitely, to decide something, you should definitely research. Research on both sides. What is what you are and what things you would like. And whatever I like, I should also have a research into how I would get there. For example, a very creative person, you know, may not be sometimes fitting into, let us say, he goes into medical science where, you know, everything happens basically within the framework of a body of knowledge. So the creativity may be limited in some domain. Or a person who is more of a system-oriented nature, sometimes if he jumps into a creative side like into Google or Amazon, onto the creative side, he may sometimes struggle. So when you got a desire, definitely you got to research as to, you know, what kind of person you are, what you want to do. So it is our duty to keep ourselves happy. So you should definitely take time as to, you know, you should speak to yourself and deeply, and, you know, come out with your own reflection as to what you want to. Otherwise, you know, definitely maybe after 2 years or 3 years or 5 years, or even after 10 years, sometimes you would start regretting. So how do you appraise yourself? How do you analyze yourself? Talk to yourself, you know, think, you know, what kind of things you like to do. You know, what type of person. There are a lot of, you know, inventory of, you know, tests that you can take to understand what type of personality you are. Good companies like TCS or Infosys or, you know, Amazon, which comes to placement in QSAT, you know, conduct a series of, you know, psychometric tests to understand, you know, what type of personality you are. But if you are appointed to this particular job, whether you will be happy or not. Even in defense, when you go for, you know, short service commission and all, you would have heard that, like, no, initially, you know, what they go through is, you know, interviews with the psychologist or, you know, psychometric testing. Whether, you know, they will be fit into a particular job or fit into their particular framework. So this is very important, you know. Since your friend is doing this, or most of your friends are doing this, you should not jump into that. You should, every individual is different. So you should speak to yourself as to what you want and what type of person you are. And you should be bold also. I was speaking to many of the students in many of the government colleges also, or across different institutions. I could see that, you know, most of them say they want to get into a PSC kind of job. Nothing wrong in it. It is a vibrant job, but, you know, a PSC would have 10 vacancies, but there will be 10 lakh or, you know, 1 lakh number of applicants. So it is, if you get it, good. But if you don't get it, you're not going to lose anything. You know, there are more vibrant and, you know, other possibilities also. So don't be very narrow as to, I would go write a bank test. Since, you know, bank jobs are supposed to be very, very safe. My wife is working with the State Bank of India. Every month, you know, she would be saying that I'll be continuing only for 2 months. After that, I would want to resign. Because it's not a kind of enjoyable job. So whether you would fit into that or not is a question. So don't limit something like the conventional careers. I want to be a banker. I want to become a civil servant. Not everybody can be a civil servant. It requires certain personality traits. Not everybody should go into, you know, PSC jobs. Not everybody need to go into the defense field. So that is something which you got to decide yourself. If you are not able to decide yourself, you can speak probably to your parents or to a professional, you know, career counselor as to, you know, how you can, what type of job would be fitting for you. That is something you have to take scientifically. That part is something you have to do. I cannot help you out on that. Nor somebody else would be able to help you on that. You have to find your own route. But, you know, probably you can take the help of a professional career counselor also. Once you're done that, the next area of research that you would want to, you know, spend time on is like, you know, I have decided this is what I want. So you should always have, you know, two or three alternate plans, plan A, B, C, or D. You should not regret that I targeted for this, finally I did not end up getting that. So then again, you know, possibilities of depression, you know, your character, you will become more aggressive. So always keep a portfolio of, you know, alternatives as to something, you know, or you can prioritize and you have to research as to how to get there. If you want to be an entrepreneur, okay, so I want to be an entrepreneur. I need some more skill set. I want to do a good management program. Or I want to be an entrepreneur. I want to have some technical knowledge about the particular product that I want to develop. I need to start, go and study in IIT or some other good institutes to get some knowledge about technology. So how to get there? So that is not easy. You have to target the institution. Once you target the institution, you have to probably read the blogs or speak out with alumni or senior students there as to how you would get there, what is the life there, what you get to learn there, what are the processes of admissions there. So most of the students, or even yesterday, I got at least 20 calls from different parts regarding QSAT admission as to how I should prepare. Nobody has planned that earlier to write the CAT or CMAT exam. So at the 11th hour, if you plan it, you may not get it correct. So that's why I said you have to decide as to what you want to do. What is that? What are your skill set? You have to finally decide upon your path. Then you have to research upon once you have decided as to what you want, that to research how to go forward. Research means investigate, navigate through the ecosystem to find out how the effort will actually take you to your desired destination. When I say destination, the students, let me tell you, don't keep one destination. Maybe a few of them will say that, no, I'm confident, I will only aim for this. That is a different style, nothing wrong in it. But generally, I would say, don't keep a single destination. You can have two or three destinations where, which can be complementary to each other, and you can prioritize them and themselves. So that, you may not regret as to, finally, I lost out on what I wanted to. And once you research as to how you want to navigate to your destination, then the important part is you have to prepare for that. You want to go into Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, Calcutta, or QSAT, or in the either University of Hyderabad or JNU, then you have to prepare to actually get into that as to how you would write the examination, which examination to take, how much cutoff you have to earn, how do you do they give weightage for the personal interview, or do they give weightage for group discussion? Some institute give weightage for their statement of objectives. They will ask you to Delhi St. Stephen's and all. They basically give priority for your object statement. So preparing for the target institution is again very important, because if you target good institutions, there'll be a lot of competition. So if you prepare systematically and task yourself, then you would be getting there. So these are the three things that you should adopt so that you don't find yourself into a depression, or you don't find yourself into a undesirable situation after 1 year or 2 years, since you are not done your career plan. Okay, I think what I have conveyed what I wanted to say. Now, if I go to anything somebody wanted to ask me at this point of time? Anybody?
Sir, I have a kind of a general question.
What is it?
Sir, in engineering, see, there's no guarantee that if you enroll for an engineering program, say BTech, you will end up being an engineer, right? Because of course, the academic background doesn't ensure you're actually capable of, practicing engineering in the industry. But it doesn't apply the other way around, because if you don't have an engineering education, no matter how passionate you are, it doesn't really make sense, because you have to have a certain level of mathematical foundation to actually succeed in the industry. Because you need engineering education to be an engineer, but engineering education doesn't guarantee that you'll be a great engineer. So is it kind of the same for management? Like, can somebody get into management job without actually ever having enrolled in any management program before? Like, how important is formal management education if someone wants to be an entrepreneur, say a BTech holder or somebody, or a practicing engineer for that matter, and he doesn't have an MBA for say, and he want to get into management?
Yeah, I think I got it. What is your name?
Sir, I didn't hear you.
What is your name?
Ganesh.
Ganesh, you are an engineering student?
Currently in my final semester, yeah.
Okay. Ganesh, first of all, let me tell you, management education is not at all mandatory for becoming a good manager. Okay. As it would be something, an engineering degree need not be something which is very mandatory for becoming a good a techie or a engineer. You would have read in many newspapers, 70% of the engineers are not employable in India. The fact is not different with management graduates also. Maybe 80% of the management graduates are not employable as managers. All these things are because, you know, the previous slide which we are talking about, you have not actually navigated to, you know, where you want to actually, you know, settle down, where you want to reach. You join for an engineering program and you assume that the engineering degree would take you to a good destination. No, it would not. You join for a management program and don't assume that it will take you to a good destination. You have to actually, you know, research, you have to understand your surroundings as to what, you know, probably the society wants from you, what the industry wants from you. Now, if you just let me put you a point. You are employed as a store manager in a supermarket like Reliance. Okay, so what probably the shopping community would want from you is not only that, you know, you keep the stocks properly, you keep it at their good prices. Probably they also want some other you know, utilities from there. Probably, you know, they would want the shopping experience. They would want like to carry their children to this particular place so that, you know, they would also enjoy while shopping. They will learn while shopping. Do not. They have some exposure to, you know, new products and new trends. So other than, you know, merchandising, they would also expect a good shopping space to educate them on as to what are, you know, the new products or services that are coming to the market lately. So, you know, management, when you just complete MBA degree, it doesn't mean that you become a manager. You should be able to read, you know, what a person wants to read the mind of a person as to what he wants, or what he would like, or what he would enjoy once he steps into the school. So that is why I said it is also something like, you know, a skill. So you should have actually decided that before even joining the program, that you would be a person who would be having the skill, or who would be who would be capable of, you know, understanding, you know, indirectly without a direct communication, understanding as to what people would like to feel like when they come into a store, or what they would like to feel when they step into a restaurant, or what they would like to feel in when they step on board into an airline. It is not written in the textbook that, you know, a family that would come in would also want good parking space. Or it would not be written in the textbook that, you know, a family who would come in would also, you know, expect some entertainment for the children once they spend 2 hours of shopping in a mall. So these are the things that, you know, you should actually, well, that should come out of you. That's what, you know, maybe the gap that you're talking. You complete an engineering degree, necessarily not take you to become an engineer. You should actually navigate and find as to what the industry wants from an engineer, and you should reposition yourself among that, within that. Engineering degree would only be a filtering kind of thing to choose some engineers from thousands of engineering colleges in the country. Are you getting me? So, are you an engineer? Okay, you would be into the recruitment process. It doesn't mean that you are appointed or you get a placement. So once you get filtered out from others as to, okay, you have some basic understanding of a professional body of knowledge. So within that, now they will apply, you know, a psychometric test to know what type of personality you are. Are you good for actually sales? Are you good for actually, you know, promoting a product? Are you creative? Are you able to understand the customer's needs? So there will be a lot of psychometric tests to actually find out a correct person. And once you are through that, then probably your engineering degree or a management degree will.
I was suggesting that there are certain things in engineering education that you actually can live without. If you get a B.Tech degree, you're not necessarily an engineer with a B.Tech degree. But, you know, if you're someone without a B.Tech degree, I mean, with no formal engineering background, and if you try to practice engineering, no matter how hard you work, you will end up working like 10 hours in mastering the technology, basically, because you do need some basics that come from your formal education. So I was asking if that applies to management in one sense. Like,
it also applies, you know, without even management degree, there are a lot of people who can actually, you know, become even better managers. So it is only a helping tool for you that, you know, you have a management degree so that you have some initial identity to the management fraternity. You have an initial identity. That is what it can give you. Now, how more you can associate through your management degree with the industry depends upon from each institute you are taking. So it can give you an identity, but even without that, if you struggle or initially task for a few years and prove within your community, definitely that can actually, that would be enough. But when we talk to a larger numbers, in general, we cannot say that always you take the risk of doing it yourself. You take the risk of being an entrepreneur and maybe slowly you will actually get it to the track. That is not applicable to the entire world. Probably few people who have in their blood to be an entrepreneur can actually practice. So even without a management degree, yes, you can be a successful manager, provided you have done the background work for that. A person who, there are a lot of people now who are very creative, and with the creative skill, they would have also developed some interpersonal skills or some organizing skills, and they may sometimes organize a small boutique or some other businesses which they can actually host in their local community or in the local domestic market, and slowly they will take off from there. So that is possible, but let me not say that that is something which is general, which is applicable to a larger population. Few people who are which is already in their blood can actually take that route, but I am trying to address a general community. Is it clear, Ganesh?
So, yeah.
So, again, to be precise, it doesn't require a management degree to be a manager, definitely. But, since, we all are trying to take the bus route to actually reach our destination, a professional education will definitely give an identity to that fraternity. So, if you... But again, let me say, you complete a professional degree, it does not mean that you are going to be successful. Only for that, you are taking a degree, but it will only give an initial energy for you to actually jump into the market and place yours. But from there, you should have your own fuel to actually propel. Okay. So now, when I focus into, I come from a School of Management Studies, you can focus for management education at international level. And now again, it is much more easier than earlier this thing, because even India is part of Study in India program, where I forgot to tell you that our department at School of Management Studies, at least in every class, I think I could find three or four students who are foreign students. Similarly, every other university at every place, a very different place in the world, they also have this program where they would accommodate students from other countries. That could be sometimes sponsored, that could be sometimes based on scholarship, that could be sometimes based on exchange agreement between the institutions. So which means the cost has actually come down. I take a student from there, and in turn I send two students to that university. So it's a barter system. So the cost does not come on the students' shoulders. So we can plan something for international, to take a completely international program. You could go to US I used to take sessions in Western Michigan University in the US. You could have a lot of Indian students there. And when I was working with my previous institute, there were a lot of students from Western Michigan University also studying here. So, that kind of thing also you can plan very well if you want to look at an international program, but definitely that will take a longer duration of for career planning. You cannot simply see an advertisement or since some career agent said that this institute is good, go pack your bags and go there. No. You should have some deeper understanding with interaction with the people who have studied there, passed out from there, etc. So if you can spend more and deep time into that, international exposure are now much more feasible, much more possible, and much more economic. You can look for scholarships like Fulbright scholarship, that scholarship is there. For that matter, I think most of the countries have some exchange scholarship between our countries. So that is something one which you can look at it. I'm not touching upon the top institutes like Harvard or Kellogg's or Michigan Institute, etc., which is something much more difficult to get in. I'm talking about generally other good institutes internationally. At national level, if you look at, obviously the first thing that you would come to use Indian Institute of Management, I am Ahmedabad, Bangalore, we have Calcutta, you have. Now I think there are more than 22 IIMs. Few of my colleagues who was with me is now with IIM Bodh Gaya, and one is with IIM Jammu. So these are all IIMs which have started within 2 years. Which I'm trying to tell you is there are a lot of seeds in Indian Institute of Management. Number of seeds are now more, so that the chance of somebody getting into it will also be likely slightly higher if you prepare well. So at national levels, you can look at IIMs, you could look at central universities like JNUs or University of Hyderabad or other leading universities like Madras University, Cochin University of Science and Technology. You can look at Bombay University, Banaras Hindu University, or you could look at University of Calcutta, there are many other prestigious universities where you have good economics management departments. At national level, definitely IIMs and central and state leading state universities are something that you have to target. And other good institutes like you have Symbiosis or IRMA or XLRA, which are autonomous institutions. Somewhat at par with MBI, somewhat at par with national level or central state university. These are the three categories that you have to look at, and you have to decide upon how you would target some institute in these three sectors. What are the parameters that you would generally look at? One is ranking. Whichever institute you go, there is no much difference in the fees that you pay. You would end up paying 6 lakhs to anywhere between 35 lakhs for a good management program. In IIMs, if you go, the fees would be somewhere between 20 lakhs to 35 lakhs in the Institute of Management. IRMA or XLRI, etc. also goes, the fees will be somewhere around 15 lakh rupees, 20 lakh. Good institutes will have that kind of range. Maybe at universities, central and state universities, since it is directly funded by the government, the fees would be much lower. For example, CUSAT, I think, is one of the oldest management institutes in the country. I think it would be one of the oldest 5 management institutes in the country. I think it started in 1964, before even many of the IIMs have started. Some institutes, government-funded institutes like universities and central universities, the fees would be really low. I think at CUSAT, the fees would be somewhere around 25,000 per semester. So it would be 2 lakh for the course, which is around 10 or 20 times if you go to many other national institutes. So cost is one factor. Cost and ROI. What do you mean by ROI? Usually the rule of thumb is, once you get placed with some company, you should be able to recover the cost in 1 year. If you look at ROI at IIM, it is very good because, they get a placement of somewhere around 12 lakhs to 25 lakhs per annum salary. So within 1.5 years, you can recover the cost. So that way also you can look at shortlisting access to what institute. You go to a private institute in Bangalore, you pay a 15 lakh rupees and another 5 lakh or 10 lakh rupees for your accommodation and stay there. You end up paying 20, 25 lakh. And finally, you end up getting a job at a very prestigious company, but the salary is only 3 lakh per annum. You go to Goldman Sachs and you get at the data entry level, you get a job. The company is very prestigious. Somebody says that you work at Goldman Sachs, but the salary is only 3 lakh or 4 lakh rupees. You're really a data entry operator there. So the ROI is very poor. You will take at least 5 years, 10 years to recover your cost of delivery. So that is what you have to look at. If you look at placements in School of Management Studies at CUSAT, if I could give you the statistics, it is... if I have the stats, let me see. If you look at here, I think at School of Management Studies, we have the highest salary for the last year was around 16 lakh rupees, but let us not go by that. I think only 4 or 5 students got into that with Amazon. But the average salary was around 6.5 lakhs or 6.7 lakhs per annum, which is good enough given that the fees is only 2 lakh rupees. The ROI is very high. So that's what I was trying to look at. Any institute you look at, you have to look at the ROI part. Whether the cost to company, the salary that you would get, be it an engineering job or be it a management job or be it any kind of other jobs. One and a half years should be the maximum time you should require to cover your cost of income. So that is regarding cost and ROI. Ranking. Definitely, if you get into the first rank institution, that is good. But you know, maybe in the first rank institution, there will be 350 seats at IIM Ahmedabad. So other students also need to study. So you have to look at ranking below that also. But whatever be, let us say, you have ranking like NIRF or NAC something. So you should look into first 100 institutes. I think QSAT comes under top 50. But up to one top 100 institutes, yes, maybe you can look at taking your professional programs in good. NAC is another good ranking, accreditation rather. NAC or NBA is a good accreditation. So those institutes with the NBA accredited or NAC accredited, QSAT is a NAC A grade accredited institute. I think most of the institutes are now in the process of accreditation. So these are the something ranking and accreditations which you can look at. Accreditations are there are also international accreditations like AMBA, ACBSP. ACBSP everybody will have WACBSP you have to look at. Few institutes only have WACBSP based accreditation. QSAT at present do not have that because it's a government institution. ACBSP, AMBA is all private accreditation. So we are not attuned to that. But some if you're looking for the institute, they have these accreditations, yes. That is something, a good sign of your institution. So if it is internationally accredited, it simply means that you go to Germany or any other European countries or you go to US, you know, your degree would be at par with their degree. So international accreditations like AMBA and WCBSP and all are good accreditations that you can look at. Location, you can look at in both dimensions. I would say that, after completing your graduation, unless you have some other obligation or necessity, you should come out from your comfort zone and try to do your professional education somewhere not very close to your domicile. Go to some other state or go to some other place and try to do it. So that that actually builds up your personality, that has builds up many of your strengths. So don't say that this is my institution which is close to my house, or this is my institution where most of my graduate friends are going, or this is my institute where I can reach without any difficulty. So don't choose institutions based on this criteria. Rather, the location should not be a constraint for you. In fact, to get into good institutions, you have to break that barrier and go and look at getting placed in. Curriculum is very important, though it is a very traditional point. Curriculum does not mean updating the syllabus every year. Every year syllabus is updated, it doesn't mean that the curriculum is good. So who updates the syllabus? Does it actually fall in par with industry or not? Fourth revolution, industry revolution, does the curriculum actually take into the requirements of fourth revolution? Does it actually make you industry ready? So it doesn't mean that we update the syllabus every year. That is a good question. You have to actually spend time on understanding what is actually offered to you. Does it actually at least par with good institutes internationally? Do they actually give scope for interdisciplinary studies? That is now a trend in universities. In QSAT, if you look at you can take management program and take electives from, let us say, legal studies. You can take electives from mathematics department or statistics department, or you can take electives from economics department, or you can take electives from IPR, intellectual property rights. Our PG student of law can take an elective from MBA management department, or an economics student can take an elective from management department. So when the electives are made interdisciplinary, it gives a mix of students in an elective batch, and that actually makes the batch very vibrant. Lot of new perspectives will come out. Lot of new discussions will come out. So that should actually, the curriculum should actually give the scope for taking interdisciplinary and flexible. The new education policy even talks about science institutions or technology institutions to have more of arts and science departments, so that we can have inter departmental elections. That is something very important which you have to keep in mind. Faculty is one of the main pillars of any management institute, especially because it is a network of the faculty which brings in the number of companies. So based in QSAT, we have 58 or 64, if I am correct, I don't remember the correct number of companies which have come for placement. So it depends upon the network of faculty, whether the faculties are in the board of different companies, whether the faculty are consultant to different companies. to the faculty, the trainers to different companies. All these things actually brings in more companies for people. So other than research output, you know, these things are also important. Definitely research is also important. In School of Management Studies, we have around 80-90 research scholars, PhD scholars. So all these research output or the knowledge which comes out as part of the PhD program, this also gets distributed or spread across the PG students. So you could also get more of insights into the research outputs of the research community in a university. The resources like, for example, are cases being used in discussion? Are simulations being used in discussion? Are there concurrent fieldworks? Are there, how was the summer program, summer placement programs dealt in a company? Is it something seriously done? Does it actually give you exposure to know how a company works? Usually, summer placement becomes the initial step for actually the final placement. Is it not? What kind of databases are there? Do your institution have Bloomberg? Bloomberg is very costly. It is around 22 lakhs per annum. Does it have databases like DevScience or Scopus or Capital Line? These are all subscribed databases which are costly. Only when you have these databases, you can actually work in a fourth revolution industry. Because most of the decisions are based on data. Critical data, data analytics. So other resources, what are the other resources that are available? Other than the conventional library, what other resources, what other journals are available are also very important when you actually choose a management institute. Placement is very important. It is a mandatory disclosure as far as NIRF. So you should don't look at the highest salary. School of Management studies offered 16 lakhs last year. Don't go by that. Everybody is not going to get that. Go for an average salary, go for a 3 years average salary or a 2 years average salary at least, so that you get a stable figure to know how much is that you can actually recover. What would be your ROI? What type of companies are being placed? Does good companies come in and place you where you have a learning curve? Sometimes, there are a lot of companies which offer you reasonably good salary, but you don't have any learning curve. You are only part of a labor there. Like completely into data data entries or call center kind of jobs or completely into sales without understanding marketing. So does it give you a learning curve? You should be able to grow up the ladder by building a learning curve for yourself. So the job that is being offered to you, what band they are placing you? Are they placing you in a management cadre or are they placing you in a ordinary cadre? Probably initially the salary will be not much different, but always trying to come into a professional cadre. So that is very important. Pedagogy is very important. Pedagogy is very important because this generation does not find it very comfortable by studying with lectures or reading the textbooks. So how is it delivered? Now, how is it simulated? Are they using good cases? Most of the good cases will require subscriptions at $3, $4 per case. So if you are having 30 students in a batch, you would require to spend $120 for downloading a good case. But you should look at whether the institute actually provides for such such pedagogy. Are cases included in the pedagogy or are simulations included in the pedagogy? From this year onwards, School of Management Studies at QZAG includes simulations in their teaching courses, teaching pedagogy. We have either Harvard or systems simulations which are included in the pedagogy, which makes it much more industry ready and much more vibrant when something is discussed. It is costly. It could run into lakhs, but however, when an institute spends that on the students, definitely your value for money is much higher. So look at the pedagogy as to how the delivery is made in a management education, which is very important. Already discussed you regarding what is Industry 4.0. It is the latest industry revolution which we can talk about, where conventional many things have become outdated. That is what many times we talk about. Are you industry ready? Now, what you require is, we require the fourth revolution industry candidates who are actually getting this. So does your industry, does your overall alignment of the institute fall in track with industry 4.0? That again, you have to check it. So these are broad points that you can actually discuss when you choose a management institute. Obviously, you can also take feedback from the alumni or the existing students from those institutes, which would be also very useful for you. But only after deciding upon these, you should actually go for taking a management institute. Now, anything at this point you wanted to ask me? Anybody? Yeah?
Sir?
Yes?
We have a question answer section later, so it will be better if we...
You can just keep something if you want to ask, and you can keep it towards the end. So yes. I was talking about who you are, discovering yourself as to what you want to become, and then looking around you and navigating through your surroundings to actually approach your target institution. So once you I'm talking about now management discipline. So once you end up in the correct management institute for doing your professional management program, what can you expect as career once you complete the PG? So fundamentally, you should look at three things. The career should be challenging. Challenging means, it should be for somebody, it should be more on the creative side. Somebody, it should be more on the analytic side. For somebody, it could be more on technology based. So challenge can be different for different people. So what I'm meaning by challenging is, it should be a pleasant challenge which keeps you engaged in an enjoyable way in the career. It should not be something like I'm doing a task, I'm doing something which is a load for me. Rather, it should be challenging which I'm keeping on enjoying. Only then you can actually navigate further peacefully in the career. So, so a management career is something which offers such a challenge. It is not easy, but it is equally enjoyable. You would have heard about targets, you would have heard about, key result area. So there are a lot of pressures that would come out in a management career. But once you are professionally built for that, to get professionally built, definitely you should actually associate with a good institute. But once you are professionally built for that, yes, you can have the challenge, enjoyable exercise as you proceed along with career. That should also, take you to a learning curve. I work for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. It is not that based on my years of experience I get promoted or I get a better job. It is based on how you accumulate your skill set and knowledge to actually move to the next level. Okay, so there should be a learning curve, and that learning should be cumulative. That is based on your exposure and your gaining of skill set from the job. That accumulates with you, and that takes you to a better job, or that takes you to better professional. This is basically fundamentally all management jobs would actually should be providing. Good management jobs should be challenging. There should be a learning curve, and that learning should be cumulative. That is every other quarter, every 3 months you work, you are now worth more. Worth more means you can demand a higher pay because I have accumulated some of more skill set working for this month. So next month, that's why you would have heard about every 6 month or every 1 month there is performance appraisal for managers. It simply means that it is a fact that every manager becomes worth more and more after 3 months or 6 months. So every 6 months, if the company does not give them an appraisal, they will jump to some other company. That's why in management, the companies, appraisals are very happening more frequently. It also is on the other side. If you do not build a learning curve, you could also lose your job. On both sides, I'm talking, there should be a learning curve, and that should be accumulated. So management institute, I already spoken to you. You have IIMs, you have IITs, you have central and state universities, you have good ranked autonomous institutes. So you can also look about institutes abroad. That's also possible. Now with the mandatory NIR of requirements and other regulatory requirements, it's not easy to know what an institute is all about, how much work it is. That is a mandatory requirement in their website. You can look at the NIR of disclosures in the website. These are all required information for, you know, making an evaluation of the institute available. So this is also very important, especially those who are not planned ahead. C4 management program across any management program across our country, it will require basically a graduate program. You require a 50% mark for a graduate program. It will also require a valid entrance score. Okay, if you're looking at IIMs, you require a CAT, IIM CAT. Only if you have a cleared and got adequate score in IIM CAT, you'll get a call for interview. Cochin University also adopts IIM CAT for their admission. Apart from that, Cochin University also adopts CMAT. CMAT is something conducted at national level by, National Assessment Agency or National Testing Agency, I think. So they conduct the CMAT, or as per the government instruction, we also adopt KMAT. KMAT means, which is the entrance exam for MBA education conducted by the Kerala Entrance Commission. So these are the only three tests, you know, that is valid for all government recognized MBA programs. As far as Cochin University is concerned also, these are the three only entrance tests that we take. As for now, CAT is over, CMAT is over. I think KMAT is on 11th of April. I don't know whether the date for registration is extended. So that you can check with the KMAT website. So this is regarding the eligibility criteria, which I think is very simple. So now if you would want to have some information about MBA at School of Management Studies, a candidate had to apply for any of these three entrance program, entrance test, either IIM CAT or CMAT or KMAT. Now get the score of either of these three entrance examination. And with this score, you can separately apply in the admission portal of Cochin University. The QSAT admission portal is now open. You can go and apply for the program. And once you get the CMAT, if you're not, a CAT score is already out. If you are waiting for the CMAT or KMAT score, you can update the score later on, which is instructed in the application website. You can click there. Yeah, that is the only thing that you have to look about. You have to apply separately. Though you apply for CAT or CMAT or KMAT, you have to separately apply in the admission portal in the QSAT website. If you're looking for some of the IIMs, I think all the new gen IIMs like IIM Jammu Kashmir, IIM Bodh Gaya, IIM Vishakhapatnam, IIM Trichy, and all, you know, I think their applications are also, we can also look at those. School of Management Studies is NAC A accredited university. Now we are going for the fourth cycle of accreditation, which comes in June. Okay, so we use reason. We have started using simulations and gamifications and case studies as major pillars of our pedagogy. You have the hostels, other resources. I think since it's a university, I need not. Explain much on other resources like, you know, other databases or other subscriptions that are available. Cost, I already spoken, probably one of the highest ROI in the country because of the lowest cost. It is completely subsidized by the government. Eligibility, I already spoken. So placements also, I think you can look at the website of your target institutions, whichever institutions you wanted to apply. But if you are, as far as QZ is concerned, I think Amazon offered the highest salary for last year, 16 lakhs. But however, few overseas placements are also there. There are around 50 plus companies which have come for placements. And around 6.7 lakhs was the average salary. The first round of placement, 26 students have been placed. When the placement season ends, that is, we start the placement season by October, November, and within 5 months. I think 85% of the students are now placed. So as far as QSAT is concerned, the placement for the last year, 85% of the students have been placed, and the average salary stands at 67 lakhs. Now, finally, if you want to have an action plan for this, if this year is too late, next year you have to prepare. You prepare for CAT definitely. IIM CAT, you definitely prepare. Try to get into some of the good IIMs. Or if IIMs you are not able to get in, you just look at for central universities or state universities and QSAT, and all you can look at. For that, please keep in mind which are the shortlisting examinations, entrance examination that you have to take on. Also keep in mind any of the entrance exam you take on, you have to separately apply to the respective institute also for getting a call for the interview. That is that. So we are done. So the basic purpose of this the session was to make you aware of, you know, how you could get into a good management institute, and also to make aware of the program that is offered by the School of Management Studies. That's it. Now, if somebody would have any questions, you can just.
So if you have any questions you'd like to ask, I'm sure Rakesh sir will be happy to answer them. Participants can either unmute and ask their queries or put their questions in the chat box.
Yeah, that should also be in the chat box.
Sir.
Yes.
Can you explain the abroad opportunities after management studies in India?
Abroad opportunities for participants in India, right? Students in India, right?
Yes, sir.
See, abroad, you know, as I said, you should take some more time because, you know, you may not have direct understanding about how an institute is. So you should find better, you should network with, you know, students though, studying in a separate institute here. You can talk about, you know, James Cook University in Australia or Western Michigan University in US. Is not, or at Thailand or at Singapore, or and even at in China you have South, even in Korea you have a lot of institute where a lot of Indian students go and study there. So rather than India, ending up paying highest fees there, just check out, you know, what are the various entrance routes, entry routes. Sometimes you would have exchange programs with the respective institute. For example, if you are joining Institute A, you would have some tie-ups with, you know, institutes abroad, where, you know, for one semester you would study there. In turn, their students would come and study here. So such programs are there where the course will, you will have a cost advantage. But you know, even other than that, you can look at, you know, DAT scholarship. You can do look at Fulbright scholarship. So there are a lot of scholarships which can take you there, where the tuition fees and accommodation fees would be completely taken. For example, for students outside India, we have something called Study in India program, which is an MHRD scheme. So that the foreign students should apply to MHRD, and MHRD will shortlist the students, and they would give you the, they would you know, allow various institutes in India. So similarly, with every other country, there are you know, you should spend time on that to understand, you know, what is the. You look at, you say, for example, you take Western Michigan University, you take the School of Management Studies there. There, you would see, you know, what are the various, you know, summer entry, you have entry during fall season. So, what are the scholarships that are available? So, that you have to check with independently, you have to check with different institutes. So, that is what I said, you require to spend more time on that. It's not very easy to find institute abroad with a good scholarship. So you have to spend time, shortlist 10-25 institutes, then start researching about what institute you want.
Thank you, sir. E-certificates will be provided to all participants. For that, I request all the participants to fill the feedback forms available in the chat box.
Okay. Any other question?
Sir, sir, another question from Stella Mulsabu. Can I know the career opportunities that make use of both BTech and management courses like MBA?
There is some advantage for a BTech students when he joins the MBA program. because, you know, mostly into technical side, production side, operation side, when some jobs are there, if you have a big BTech background, that is good enough. But there are students who are literature students also who go into operations jobs after completing MBA. So career opportunities or the advantages, again, I would say it at two levels. One is rightly choosing the institute. For example, if you are very passionate about advertisement, you would go and choose Mudra. Or if you are very passionate about industrial laws, you would go and choose XLRI. So it all depends upon, you know, if you want to get specialized, or if you want to choose in IPR, you may go and, you know, sometimes take in UALs. So if you are very specific, you can just look for some institute that specialize, super specialized into some areas, or otherwise, you know, to answer the question, if you are BTech students and you are completing MBA, you have some areas which you have some upper hand, like into supply chain or what do you call it as enterprise resource planning or prediction scheduling. So there are certain areas where, you know, BTech students with an MBA has some advantage that you would come to know when you complete your first 6 months in a management program. So that's to answer your question.
Thank you, sir. Another question from our student. What do you think about implementation of the concept of lifelong learning in a... Lifelong learning in academic field.
I think I have agreed to a point in my presentation itself. When I was talking about careers in management, if you could remember that slide, I was talking about... it should be challenging learning curve and it should be cumulative. Cumulative means it should keep on building with you as you go forward. So that is lifelong. So that's why you say even at 50 years, you know, there's an assessment for the manager at 50 years or 55 years. There'll be appraisal. Appraisal means, you know, how much you have built upon yourself, you know, by your learning, your exposure, and, you know, interacting with your surroundings, you know, how you have actually built upon you. So it is a continuous learning. Unlike other professions where the assessment is taken after 1 year, 2 years, or sometimes even after 3 or 5 years, in management, assessment happens on a monthly basis or even a quarterly basis. So it is a continuous learning. Learning doesn't mean you are completing different keeping on completing certification. It's not that. Learning means you are on the job learning. Okay, you are getting exposed to, say, for example, you are into a sales. So your learning would be like, you know, how fast you would be able to convert a potential customer into a customer, or how quickly you will be able to solve an issue. Or as an HR manager, your learning would be from the previous month where you had, you know, 25 people issue, now you could bring it down to 20 issues. The next month you will be able to bring it down to 18 issues or 17 issues. So this is a learning that, you know, builds upon along with you, which makes you more resourceful and more, you know, value for money for your company. So rather than keeping a person who was exposed to you with 3 months, now I have a person who is exposed to the environment with 1 year. Definitely a 1 year guy is expected to be more worth for the company, provided your attitude allows you to learn along with the job. So on the job is something which is on the job learning is something which is very evident and which is very part and parcel of management career. Yes, lifelong learning is part and parcel of management.
Sir.
Yes.
To pursue MBA, which is the most appropriate branch in engineering?
Rather, I would like you to reposition your question as to which is the most appropriate branch for you. Since you studied engineering, you may not actually choose a branch suitable for engineering. Rather, you should choose a branch which is most suitable for you. Okay, so that is how I put it. If you ask a branch for engineering students, it would be ERP, or it could be supply chain management, or it could be predictions, operations, systems, etc. But even before that, you should ask yourself whether is that the branch you want to do. there is nothing wrong in an engineering student coming and there are a lot of students who are very successful in finance after completing engineering. There are a lot of students who are very good in marketing after engineering. Because most of the industrial products require a lot of technical understanding and technical competency for selling it. There are a lot of engineering students who are good at HR. So it depends upon which is the best career for you or branch for you. Rather, it is you need not be worried about which is the best specialization based on what you studied. You still have one more chance to choose which is most suitable for you. So please try to think in that perspective. But otherwise, to answer your question, mostly for engineering students, assuming that you are also your personality is also linked to more of an engineering student, then probably predictions, ERP operations, supply chain, systems, all these are good specializations. Yeah, Baiju is asking something. Anybody else? Any question?
Sir, is MBA apt for introvert students?
Louder?
Is MBA apt for introvert students?
Definitely. Introvert is not a bad quality. If you apply for some job in IB, intelligence bureaus or RAW or some other agencies which require confidentiality as part of your job. Introvert personalities are many times accepted there against extrovert people. Extrovert is not always good or introvert is not always bad. In management, there are a lot of things which requires you to be a person sometimes in a very less talking, few jobs. Though in management it is said team player. Now I would, to my understanding, team is not a group of people or a team of people. It can be team of resource. Now and 4.0 industrial revolution 4.0. See the team. You may not see the team to be a group of people. A team could be only me alone or two people. Only with two people, but other factors in the team would be in other resources like systems, capital, intellectual properties, etc. So sometimes you will be working with a less number of people or even without people, but a lot of serious resources will be in your hand. So many times it would be better and you be an introvert person for that. Sometimes an introvert person, an asset manager, let me say, though it is not a classic example, just to discuss, an asset management company, an asset manager, let us say, if he is an introvert person, he could save a lot of time for studying his portfolio. He could continuously monitor his portfolio, and that could sometimes reflect in his portfolio outcomes. No. An extrovert person can be good at certain other times. An introvert person, an extrovert person, a talkative person, a creative person, a lesser creative person. A lesser creative is not something bad. See, you behind some other capability. A highly creative person, when you put him in a team, that could be something a problem because he always brings out creative idea and he always want to break the rules of the team. So always being creative is not very good. But in some other jobs, creativity is very essential. So it is not that you have a common template to say this is a good management, right? It depends upon what kind of job you want to do.
Thank you, sir. My name is Grayson.
Yeah.
And I'm from the civil department. So after my engineering degree, if I want to start my own business someday, which would be a lot more logical choice, pursuing MBA or Masters in Engineering Management?
I would be indifferent to that. It depends upon where you want to gain something. If you, for being an entrepreneur, as I said earlier, a management degree is not mandatory, nor a engineering degree is mandatory. But if you want to gain some technical advancement before you launch your business concept, or you are an architect, so you want to go to Delhi and study in School of Architecture there, definitely that would be a good idea. If you have some gap there, but if you already built that gap, you are competent, you are already during your graduate time itself, you are working with various architects, and you know to actually draw the diagrams, or you know the implications of various technical factors in your profession. Probably if you want to polish your business skill, then probably you can look for management degree. Otherwise, you can look for your technical degree. So that is what I said. There is no answer to what is good for me. It should come within you. That's what I said in the second slide. You had a desire and research. Research as to what you are and what is your current skill. Without knowing that, if you choose a degree, that would not be a correct one. So please spend some time. Think about, are you capable of independently starting off your dream? Do you have the technical skill and your working experience for that? Then probably go ahead with that. Or you could go for a management program along with that. Or if you want to first even improve your technical skill, then probably definitely you should go for your higher education in your engineering trade itself. Also keep in mind, now there are a lot of schemes for encouraging entrepreneurships. Well, I also, at this point of time, let me also tell you, at School of Management Studies, we have an incubation center, a vibrant incubation center, which is funded by government and RUSA and central government, etc. Which means, you after completing your program, you want to be an entrepreneur for a takeoff period, say, let us say 1 year or 2 years. It would not be feasible for you to set up your own space in the market. So you can use the incubation center, where from there you can operate and have a takeoff pad from there. So there you will have a lot of subsidies for rent, power, space, etc. So when you choose a management institute, also look whether the management institute also has an incubation center for the people who are looking forward for becoming an entrepreneur.
Once again, I would like to remind the participants to fill the feedback form available in the chat box. Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
What are the advantages or disadvantages of doing MBA course instead of continuing with science?
One is an apple and another one is an orange. Both are two different products. So if you ask, what is the advantage of eating an apple than an orange? How can I answer that? Okay. There is no advantage of doing an MBA replacing a PG in engineering. Or there is no disadvantage of doing an MPA replacing a PG program. It depends upon, again, let me stress on the point, it depends upon where you stand. You have to research yourself as to which skill is that you want to polish. Okay. You want to be you want to become a researcher, you want to contribute to the research output in architecture or structural engineering, or some of, you want to become a scientist, or you want to become an more competent techie person, then probably you would sharpen your technical skills. You'll go to IIT and do your M.Tech, or Indian Institute of Science and do your PG in Science. Or on the other hand, you want to leverage the systems approach in the entire world, the fourth revolution systems approach. The entire world. You have some technical knowledge. Now you want to use your interpersonal skill, you want to know with your business skills, with your economic, your management skills, you want to leverage that, and you want to keep the ball rolling. That is, you want to run a company. So for running a company, a Britannia company, you need not be a food, you need not complete something in master's in food technology or processing. It is, you would have some basic idea, but reminding you is, you are running the company by managing the people there, managing the resources, managing your capital, managing your plant machinery, managing your union, managing the legal environment. So that is something which is required to operate a particular unit. Or asset manager, you want to be an investment manager, or you want to be an investment consultant. You are an engineer, fine. It doesn't mean that you cannot manage a portfolio. You would study your management program, you would study your finance courses, And if you would like to be more exposed to the stock markets, you would like to keep a track on that, you would want to build strategies in derivatives, all those things, then probably you can take a PG course in management and you can come into this, where you can leverage your digital BTEC program. So what identity you want is important. Do you want an identity for as a scientist or as a technologist? Or do you want an identity as a manager? Both are different. Both are not bad or good. Both are two different career choices. So if you want to be a manager, like a CEO or a plant manager or a marketing manager or a distribution manager is, there you're leveraging what you've done in your BTEC programs and you're using your management and business skills to actually navigate yourself for it. So that is what you have to decide. Both are two different things.
Sir?
There is something like after your MBBS, you are asking whether I should go for MS or MD. You want to go into the surgery side or you want to go into the medical side? So there's something like that, no? Yeah.
Sir?
Yeah.
The specialization course.
Can you come again?
Courses in MBA, the traditional specializations like HR, marketing still have this computer. So what are the future specialization courses in MBA?
The traditional specializations are always like relevant HR. Because, you know, like HR or marketing or finance, all these are, you know, the basic verticals of business that never change. But what is important is how that specialization is delivered to you. You take an HR specialization and you talk about conventional recruitment. Curriculum is important. You talk about HR specialization. Now you talk about recruiting by, you know, maybe the recruiters would, you know, probably look at your social media interactions, your social media history. You would administer, you know, contemporary psychometric tests. So what is offered in a specialization is important. You take a finance specialization, you talk about manual accounting, that may be relevant. You talk about contemporary IFRS or you talk about contemporary accounting issues, you talk about derivatives, you talk about financial engineering, all these things are actually then relevant. Okay, so specialization, I don't say HR is outdated or HR is new. HR is always there. So what is offered in HR? HR analytics is a new specialization. Marketing analytics is a new specialization. Econometrics is a new specialization. Okay, so so in a specialization, does it actually offer the contemporary realities is what is important. I hope you get what I'm saying.
Yes, thank you, sir. Okay. If there are any more questions,
yeah, chat box is also. I'll just come to you. Let me just go through your chat boxes. Can I do the career opportunity that makes us both BTEC and management course career opportunity that makes use of both BTEC and management courses? Career opportunities that make use of both BTEC and management courses. Career, I think that I have already answered. I think somebody was asking that if
these questions were already asked.
Okay, this was already asked. What was the next question? Hotel management after BTEC. If you are passionate about that, then there is no second question. If you are passionate about that, then why should you ask somebody? You just don't do that. Life is something that, you know, you should spend your life doing what you are passionate about. Since you studied BTEC or since you study MBBS. But still, after that only you realize that you want to be into hotel management. If you're convinced, jump into that. Otherwise, you'll regret for the rest of your life. Do something that, you know, keeps you happy. It was seen in most of the channels. You know, you do good hotel management, you know, you can travel around. You can build your own identity as a good chef. You can build your identity as a good property developer. Is it not? So hotel management has definitely, because, you know, now only because of pandemic. Otherwise, you know, still the world is, why are we all doing jobs? We are all doing jobs for getting some money and to spend it for our happiness. Maybe somebody would like to travel. Somebody would like to go and stay somewhere for some other vacation. Somebody would like to have a family vacation. Somebody would like to have, beverages. Somebody would like to have, you know, good food. Somebody would like to have good vehicle for, you know, adventures. All these are, you know, the reasons why we are doing job. Hotel management is definitely a vibrant area. There are specialized in Trivandrum itself. There's a central government institute. What is it? Kerala Institute of Hotel Management, right? Or Indian Institute of Hotel Management, if I'm correct. Definitely. In few of the, you can look for a general MP and you can look for taking hotel management as specializations. That's possible. BTEC and hotel management, definitely, I think you can leverage. No issue with that. Yeah, next one.
Thank you, sir. That would be the end of our question and answer section. Thank you so much.
Okay. I hope I have answered all the questions. So if there are any further questions, you could just shoot me a mail through your coordinator. So thank you all for, you know, participating. The principal, the coordinator, all the faculty members who are joined in this program. Thank you all. So wish all of you do their homework and, you know, find their correct higher education institutes, those who are planning for, you know, going for higher education. Hope I can meet some of you also in School of Management Studies. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to invite Ivan Pallimari, student representative from ESSEC Mechanical Department, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, all. It's a pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks for this event. First of all, I would like to thank our chief speaker, Dr. Rakesh Krishnan M, for his valuable and informative talk. Especially, I would like to appreciate the effort taken by you to explain the topic and giving new ideas and opportunities in this field. I would also like to thank our principal, Dr. Sojan Lal, and other faculty members of MBITS College for organizing this session. Last but not the least, I thank all the audience for the active and participation and making this program a success. Once again, I thank one and all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Once again, thank you all for your active participation.
Yes. Okay, thank you. So shall I leave the meeting?
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.